Welcome to the NX for Manufacturing Tech Tips. Today's tech tip is titled Introduction to Programming Milturn Machines in NX CAM. The demonstration will last approximately 20 minutes, then we'll stay on the line and open up a chat window for questions and answers. With that, I'll turn the session over to Gurdeep Singh. Welcome, Gurdeep. Let's get started.
Hello, everyone. This tech tip session has been typically, we plan to do a Milton programming challenges. If you look into this slide, this is a typical Milton machine wherein we have multiple spindles for turning. That is a main spindle and a counter spindle. And not only that, we have multiple channels that are cutting stations. If you see here, we have a B-head, a rotary B-head, and then we have a turning turret which can mount the live tools on top of it. So this in totality forms a typical Milton application, a multi-function machine. As we can see that this throws up a lot of challenges in front of us to program these machines. Primarily the challenges are regarding the programming of these machines. And then we talk about the synchronization, how we synchronize these two channels of machines, this B head as well as the lower turret to perform the operations on the main spindle and the sub spindle in synchronized motions. Also, there are challenges thrown in front of the users for post-processing simulation. And then last but not the least, for optimization of these parts to be machined on these machines. As far as programming challenges are concerned, there are some typical requirements from a CAM software point of view. The first and foremost being we should be able to easily mount the part and set up the part on these machines. A part that has to be machined on a Milton machine has to be mounted both on the main spindle as well as the sub spindle. It's not only about the mounting of the parts. There could be special requirements for programming. We have to take care of the tools, we have to take care of the geometry views and the program sequences that we need to take care of. And the software has to be capable enough to handle those things. Another programming challenge that we face while machining these parts or creating NC operations for these parts are how to handle 3D tools and 3D devices. A lot of typical applications we'll see during the demonstration how we handle these. Also, we have to take care of multiple operation types that could be as diverse as turning operation, milling operation, continuous five-axis milling operation, drilling from both the challenges. So in totality, programming of such machines to machine the parts is a challenge, and we will see during the demonstration how this can be easily handled in NX CAM. Further to that, the synchronization and post-processing challenges that we talk about. Whenever we are programming such machines and trying to synchronize, the tool parts or the operations have to be post-processed while we are synchronizing them. It's not something that we can do internal tool part synchronization, and finally when the tool part is sent to the machine tool, it is not behaving the same way. So this is one of the challenges that has to be taken care of. Like we said that we are taking care of multiple operation types, turning, milling and so on, five axis operations. So the post processes for these operation types have also to be linked so that they can work efficiently. Operation before starting synchronization, we have to take care of sequencing of the operations, which is very critical to synchronization. And the challenge is to have a flexibility in the tool while we are synchronizing the channels to add the sync marks or the sync events flexibly and have be able to optimize these operations. As we have touched upon the synchronization, another challenge that we face here typically on these complex Milton machines is the simulation and verification challenges that we have, because there are a lot of machine kinematics involved while simulation. So we need to take care of those machine kinematics in a model, as a 3D model. Another important is the part geometry and the IPW generation. The IPW has to transform from your main spindle to counter spindle. And also the part transfer has to happen from the main spindle to the counter spindle. Not only that, 3D devices and the two 3D tools have to be checked for collision. So we do need to support all these kind of tools. As we see on the lower turrets, many a times a tool has to perform a function on the main spindle, and for the dual post tools, the same number of the tool will be performing the operation on your counter spindle. So those kind of tools will also need to be handled. So we will see how we can handle these things in NXCAM in a short while. Another challenge that these Milton machines throw in front of a programmer are that the solution has to give you an accurate time calculation, because it is based on the feed rates. The synchronization is based on the feed rates, and in turning operations, many times the feed rates are calculated based on the diameters that are being machined, typically in turning operations. So the calculation has to be very accurate, and efficient sequencing and the flexibility to make these make changes to these sequences. So I'll quickly go ahead and show some of the things in live demonstration. So I would just quickly stop sharing this slide and go to share my screen. If you see here, this is a typical Milton application part having turning operations to be performed. Not only that, we have some milling faces that need to be milled out, and then there are some buckets combined with the holes on the PCB as well as holes on the cylindrical periphery. Not only that, we have this operator needs this part needs to machine in double settings, so mainly on the main spindle as well as on the counter spindle. The first challenge that part that was how we can set up this part very quickly on such a complex machine and have the environment ready pretty easily. And we need to have an environment, not only for, we can customize the environment for one single part, but how about if every time you have a new part? So that kind of flexibility has to be there in a system in order to give you an efficient setup and environment setup for programming. So for that, typically, NX templates happen to be a great help while setting up these parts. Let me quickly show you that. If we go to start a new file, I have already created, this is the part that we have with us. The only thing that we need to take care of is the coordinate system has to be at the plane of rotation, XY plane has to be according to your turning plane, so which is already set. Other than that, if we can go into manufacturing and we can have templates created here. What I typically template that I will use or I have created for this demonstration is that configuration 3 template, which is which will install and set up the environment for me. I can quickly change the name here. Let's say Milton Tech Tip Part Setup 1. Now this is going to reference the part, going to use the master model concept for setting up the part. If we're going to use this Milton part portion, and this is the new setup environment that we'll be creating. And when I click just OK, it will start to load all the requirements as defined in the templates for setting up of this part. And quickly we'll see the part mounted on the main spindle, and not only on the main spindle but also on the counter spindle as well. Now this typically is happening because we have set up the template like that. It's not only the parts will be mounted to their correct position. So as you see here, parts are coming to the right location. We can see that the part is mounted on the counter spindle, and it will also be mounted on the main spindle. So as we see here, the thing that we see here, the part is mounted on the main spindle as well as on the counter spindle. So quick question comes to our mind that how about if the length of the parts are changing? So that can be pretty easy to handle with the assembly navigator. We can position the parts dynamically with the dynamic coordinate handler. We can add a value or simply drag and position the part as desired. Similarly, we can move the part on the main spindle as well. Let's move this part, and if I need to move it out, we can just pull the thing out and place it as we desire. So this can be handled for any length of the part, but the part locations are set always at the center of your chucks. So this is pretty easy way of setting up these parts, setting up the complex prismatic parts onto these complex machines. Not only that, if we go into the operation navigator, what we see here is in the geometry views, what we mentioned that we need to take care of geometry view, we need to take care of machine tool view. Has there any been help regarding that? So typically, the whole structure that is needed for programming these parts will be automatically created. Like we need a main spin, we need a main G54 for a main spindle, and then there is a sub coordinate system for sub spindle created. Anyhow, we have to change the position with respect to the part length. We have a main, we have a coordinate system for the main spindle created for turning as well as for milling, and similarly for the counter spindle as well. So this complex structure is automatically created based on template. Now if we go into machine tool view, which is very important while programming these creating NC operations on these Milton machines, we have a main spindle mount and we see a chuck already loaded along with that, and that too on both the spindles, main spindle and the counter spindle. We have turret pocket created as well as the spindle pocket. A turret pocket are for the lower turret, and this spindle single pocket is for your B head. And then we have a program order view, which will create a sync group, which we are going to synchronize later on. So by just selecting the right template, by setting up the environment with the right setup template, we can actually mount any kind of part very quickly, making the environment work easily. Now, another thing to take care of here is about the tools, how we can handle the tools, the 3D tools as devices. Typically, let's say if we want to mount a holder onto the lower turret, we can quickly go and double click here on the machine that has been added, and we can retrieve the device from the library. If we go here in the tool holders, we have here a tool holder typically created, let's say a duo block tool holder, which has been created for this template. So if we just click OK, the tool holder will be mounted onto one of the pockets. So if you see here, this is a tool which will be numbered, let's say this is tool number one, but while performing the operations, it has two pockets. The tool pocket on the left has to perform the operation on the main spindle, and the tool pocket on the right has to handle the operation on the counter spindle. But it's the same tool number. Let's say we go and add a 3D tool into it. We can right click on the pocket and just say insert a tool, and we go and retrieve it from the library. I would go into turning tool. Let's say I give a reference by which I have already added some of the tools in this. So here will be the tool list of tools from where we can select the tool that needs to be mounted here. Typically, we can mount a tool, and let's say I want to mount a tool with a D-type insert. Let's say OK. a tool has been mounted onto the pocket. I can quickly switch, it's pretty easy to switch the tools from one pocket to the next pocket. So if you can see, the tool has been created for this pocket. It's a 3D tool. It's no longer a tool created on a fly, which has been added. So NX is able to handle any kind of 3D tools that you can create. We'll quickly create another tool into pocket number one. Let's say insert a tool. Let's say tools from the library. Again, I would go and look for my library reference number. And typically, let's say I would like to add a tool with C-type insert. Let's say OK. The challenge here is how this tool with the same number can perform the operation on how is it handling the junctions or the tool register numbers. So though the number of the tool will be the same, but what we can do here is if you double click on any of the tools, we can actually change the tool register number as 1 or tool mounted on the pocket number 1, and similarly we can change the tool register number as 2 for the other tool, which will take care of the correct positioning of the tools when they are performing the operations. So this is how we can handle the tools with multiple inserts as well. There is a quick way when the tool geometries are really complex and you would want to have a simplified operations. Simplified, not really, you won't like to switch between these tools. So what we can do is insert another tool here. Let's say I would go and insert a tool from the library, again, a turning tool, and look for the references here. And we can typically add a tool, let's say a W-type tool onto pocket number 2, which will be mounted. But this time, the tool is not only the tool body itself, but it comes with the holder. So the whole assembly has been added as a tool. Now, NX gives you a flexibility for the programming ease that we can add a tool, multiple tools into the same pocket, but for that, we can change the capacity of tool from 1 to 2. So from the programming aspect, ease of programming, we can actually mount 2 tools in the same pocket. Let's say insert tool. Again, I would go for a turning tool here. I would look for an MPG reference. And let's say I would add another tool, C-type tool, into the same pocket. We see here the tool has been added to the same pocket. So there are the two different flexible ways of handling the 3D data. We can also add a 3D tool, a typical 3D tool, onto the spindle as well on the main pocket. Let's say insert a tool. And again, we can retrieve it from the library. Turning tool for the main spindle from the B head. We go and look for the reference numbers, and we can mount this tool. The tool will be added onto the spindle pocket. And as we expand this, we have a tool created here. And you will see a tool appearing in the pocket. Once we highlight that, the tool is appearing in the pocket here. So that's a turning tool for the main spindle. You can also go and add a lot of other devices for holding the drills and so on. Really, this is how we can handle, NX gives you a very flexible solution first to mount the parts, create the setup environment, and a flexible solution to handle the 3D tools and devices. Let's quickly go and have a look at some of the operations that we can, how we can create the operations which we have already done, and I'll quickly show you how these operations are running while we are doing the simulation. Now, typically here, what we have here, we have, as you see on the turret below, we have a lot of drills that are going to perform operation for the radial drills on the periphery of the cylinder. Also, we have live tools mounted for performing the PCD drilling operations and some operations to perform turning tools. And there are a few operations that are performed from the main spindle. How we can quickly make out which operations are performed from, so if we go typically into a program view, if you see here, we have this information regarding the channel. So the channel number, this is a two channel machine, this is the channel number one, and the lower turret is the channel number two. So every operation is marked with from which channel is this program or this operation being performed. So very quickly it gives you the information which channel is being used. We have, it's a single environment, you don't need to switch between the environments, create your facing operation as well as your milling operations. If we have here, typically we have a panel mill operation, which is a milling operation to machine out this flat around this region. Also we have machining operations typically for cavity and a continuous 5-axis operations as a contour profile for machining this pocket out. So we'll see how these options are structured in our geometry view. If you see here, we have this complex structure which was needed was automatically created based on templates, and we just need to create the operations under the geometry group where we want to perform these. If operation has to perform on the main spindle, all the operations would go under this main spindle geometry group, and any operation that has to be performed on the subspindle will go under the subspindle group. Typically, the operation navigator structure views, different views in the operation navigator structure offer a great help while programming these Milton machines. If you go into the machine tool view here, we can easily structure our programs based on which operations are performed from turret, the lower turret, as well as the operations performed from the main spindle. So the sequence of the operation is typically structured in the program order view, typically defining what is the sequence of operations we would like to run. We would quickly go have a look and see how these operations are being performed. Let's say if I perform a facing operation, I can go ahead and ask to simulate toolpath, simulate that operation. Now this is giving us the information that this is the power of the driver information, driver that is going to run the simulation, giving you output for the information that there are some identical tools mounted. It's just the information given to you. This is not exactly an error message, but information passed on to the programmer while he's performing the simulation functions. The simulation that we will be running here is not based on the internal toolpath. It will be based on the G-code that will be post-processed, that will be given out by the post-processor for turning operation. Now, typically, if you see here, that we have a visualization based on machine code. If I quickly, step-by-step process through that, you will quickly start to see NC code starting to appear here. So based on that, the whole simulation will be running based on this NC code. It's no longer the simulation based on internal toolpath. So the system is going to change for the tool. Just grab the tool here for our facing operation, and then we can let it go while it performs the operations. So here it is typically removing the material from the facing operation. Interesting thing here is how we can handle easily, NX can handle the special cycles required for controllers like Cinemaric. Now, if we typically go here into a contour profile operation, I can. After a few operations, we have to transfer the part from here on the main spindle to the sub spindle. IPW has to transfer from the main spindle to the counter spindle. We'll go in much more detail in the following tech tip sessions a little later on. But a quick look into it, how this has been handled. We can actually add the events here. We have added a start event to start the whenever we want to take off the part from main spindle to the subspindle, at the last operation we have added the workpiece catch by subspindle. A UDE, a user defined event, has been added. If we go and edit that, there are some parameters needed for the distance that the counter spindle has to travel and grab the part. And typically it will go and grab that part and transfer to the main spindle. It's not only main spindle, this UDE. There are typical UDEs available for facilitating the efficient cinematic programming. We have a UDE for cinematic 840D cycle, wherein we can set up the environment for Traore, for the 5-axis TCPM transformations, and so on. And if we see here, we have a parting off operation where we can create a part off operation, and then the part can be transformed from main spindle to the subspindle. It's a typical GD operation, but what we have is a machine control end of the part event here as well. Once the parting off has been done, the transfer workpiece transfer the part to the subspindle. The first UDE was to catch it, and then second was to transfer that. So this is how typically NX can help to program these complex machines. It offers a great flexibility in handling of these complex machines. Now let's see how we can synchronize the multiple channels of this particular machine. Now for that, let me open up another part here. It's the same part, but a different version of that part. Now, the moment we open up this part, we'll get to know that this particular part has been synchronized. There's a clear message indicated inside on the operation navigator. If you see here on the sync, we get a channel synchronized. All these operations are synchronized for working. Now, let's quickly start and the sync manager as an application. What we will see here is the first thing that NX is going to do once we hit the sync synchronized simulation, it has to post-process all the operations that are in the list. So it will create the NC output for that. It will create 3D tool geometries, and so that the system is ready for simulation. But while it is being preparing itself, we'll see an error message which has been deliberately induced into it, just to give you an idea how flexibly we can make the changes and add the sync events. So we'll quickly see an error message. Which will be for some error regarding that the operation is not being able to perform properly. And we'll see in the sync manager what issues we are facing here, and then how we can fix those things flexibly. Sync manager typically gives an environment where we can channelize the operation, synchronize the operation based on the two channels we have. We can drag and drop the operations for which operations to perform first. As we see, we have received an error message. I would just say OK, and we will be routed to Sync Manager. You can have a time-based calculation of these operations. So which helps, which is very critical while we are performing the operations, the optimization of these operations, because the timing has to be accurate. You see here, we have the information about channels, channel 1 and channel 2 here, and all the operations have been post-processed for both the channels. What we have here is we can have a time chart here, wherein we can have a timeline analysis, a Gantt chart analysis, where which operations are being performed. We have the legends available, what color is signifying, so it's pretty easy to understand. Before that, we would quickly like to go through the information, the error information I would like to show here. I would quickly expand this view. This is something interesting to see. We have operations here on channel 1 and channel 2. We have facing operations. If you see here, this facing operation and this center leaning operation on the main spindle is starting in tandem. As we see here, the first two operations that we have here is facing operation and center drilling operations. This is from channel 1 and channel 2, and both the operations are on the main spindle. So we cannot perform these two operations simultaneously. So we'll quickly go and drop this sync event just above this center line operation, and we have splitted these two operations. If you see here, the facing operation and the center drilling operation is now splitted between by this sync event. If we typically go here and see that there are a few more erroneous kind of operations being created here. We have all these operations before this part off are all the operations are on the main spindle. So they have to be synchronized in a way that they are working one after another. It's not necessary, but the operation types are like that they have to perform one after another. So typically, if I have to create a sync event and split these operations based on their channel of performance, so we can click anywhere. Let's say I clicked on my sync manager, and we can say insert a sync event here. We need not necessarily make any of the channel primary, so I would just say none, and a sync event would be added here. If you see here, a synchronization event number 8 has been added. But still, it doesn't really help me because the operations are not splitted between these two. NX offers us, the sync manager offers us a solution to dynamically click and drag and drop the sync events wherever we want. So I just dragged the synchronizer sync event number 8 below my rough back turning operation. And now once we go ahead and play this operation, now once you're changing these sync events, the whole post-processing of the output has to be changed. The system has to post-process the operations again, which it will do. But before going into that, we can have a different view of these operations here. We can actually expand these views and have the event-based view of like the initial move, the rapid move, every motion of the operation can be viewed here. And we can actually insert the sync events not only based on operation wise, but we can actually add the sync event based on any of the events. Let's say we have added these two this sync event number 7 just before the end of program, because once it sees M30 from any of the channel, the system is going to stop. So what we have done is we have added a sync mark just before the end of the program for both the channels. So this helps, you can actually switch, drag and drop these sync events anywhere before the initial move or before any of the engage motions to synchronize your operations to be performed on the same channel from the two different channels on the same spindles. We can also have a G-code view of our operations, wherein we'll have not the event-based view, but exactly the NC output view. How is it going to look like? So I'll quickly go switch back to my operation view. We have the visibility of my operations based on the channels, and quickly we'll have play this operations. Now before it plays the operation, it is what we can see. It is the system is post-processing all the operations again. It is calculating the 3D geometries of the tools and the tuck and the IPW for which it has to perform the operation. Before starting, we'll quickly see how we can have a 3D material removal. We can see the 3D material removal of these operations while they are being performed. We'll have to wait for the system to finish the post-processing here. This button here, we can, this is typically used for having a 3D material removal activated. There are multiple ways to have the collision detection done between the pairs of 3D tools, the turret, and the setup geometries. We'll quickly have a look at that. Once we're done, the only thing, because the more time it takes is because it has to post-process all the operations that we are performing. But flexibility to maneuver around the sync marks is a great advantage while programming such complex machines. Okay, it goes to change the tool, but before it goes to change the tool, I will quickly pause for a while and then play it in. Let's say I would like to go and show the 3D material removal. As you see here, that RPW has appeared. Not only that, in the option set, simulation option set, you can actually make the motion in-process workpiece update based on motions or based on the length increments. I would like to go here. You can define the collision pairs. If you can set the collision detection on, and you can define the pairs between which you want to find the collision. So typically, you can do such things. Let's say okay, and I would say it again. Now we see the sequence of the operations being performed one by one. I think just because of the graphics requirement for transferring this over the internet, it's taking a little, it's working a little slower. So this is the first phasing operation that is being performed from the channel 1 on the main spindle. And then we'll have a center drilling operation coming from the lower turret. So this not too sure about the how is it visually, how are you all able to visualize this depending upon the internet broadband speed that we are getting right now. So we are having a center drill coming from the lower turret, which is a live tool going to perform a center drill operation here. So immediately after that, we'll have operations based on a centerline drill that will be coming from the main spindle, coming from the B head. And then following, we'll have, it's an operation that we have performed here. A centralized drilling operation for the main spindle. This is an operation being performed at the center. This is a little bit about the internet speed, that it's running a little slower. We've quickly seen how we can set up the pot easily. We can use tools. We have seen the UDEs, and we have seen the functioning of Sync Manager.